Good evening. A warm welcome to all of you to what promises to be a very special lecture this evening by one of the leading design architects of China, as well as the entire Asia region, Professor Li Xiaodong. Before introducing tonight's speaker, allow me briefly to recap the background of our school's lecture series this spring term, with the theme of regional design in Asia, including the commitment to creating a truly innovative, integrated, sustainable architecture. Thus, we have been privileged to hear from Wong Man Sun of Woha Architects in Singapore. Last week, Wang Xianyuan of Field Office Architects in Taiwan. Our very own Professor Christoph Krolov on bamboo structures. And this evening, Professor Li Xiaodong, based in Beijing. In addition to the series, we had Tom Main of Morphosis deliver the annual Kinoshita lecture last month. And next month, there's one final public lecture for our spring term, which is Sir Terry Farrell on April 7th. So please save that date. Now, I have great pleasure to introduce our guest speaker this evening, Professor Li Xiaodong, who is both an award-winning practicing architect and chair professor of architecture at Tsinghua University in Beijing. As an educator and researcher on architecture, he has authored several publications in both Chinese and English on a wide range of topics from history and theory of architecture to cultural studies and urban design. The architectural practice of Li Xiaodong is focused on small, often self-initiated design projects that propose critical positions about what is an appropriate Chinese architecture that brings together both traditional and contemporary modes of expression, while also integrating technology and natural materials. His work is deeply connected with landscape and with communities, and strives to articulate a new regionalism in the face of unfettered globalization. In fact, his entire practice to date has encompassed perhaps no more than a dozen built works. Though I understand from him that he's now designing several ongoing projects in his practice. So, congratulations. But clearly, his is a profound commitment to quality over quantity, with each project being thoughtfully designed, carefully detailed, and addressing important social concerns, including sustainability. His designs achieve tranquility and harmony through a close understanding of light, space, and order, as well as aiming to work with nature, not against it. As a result, his projects, including the Yuhu Elementary School in Lijiang, Yunnan Province, Bridge School in Pinghe, Fujian Province, and Liyuan Library in Beijing, among others, have all been recognized with international design awards, including the Aga Khan Award, Architectural Review, Emerging Architecture Award, Arc Asia Gold Medal, UNESCO Jury Award, the Moriyama Prize from Canada, ARND Award in the UK, and Architectural Record China Awards for Best Public Building, among many others. In addition, Professor Li received honorary fellowship from the AIA. On a personal note, what impresses me most about the work and career of Li Xiaodong is the seamless alignment of his academic and professional work. And perhaps there should not really be a large distinction between being a professional architect and a professor of architecture. In the end, both comprise the same activity, which I call professing architecture. The common root of both words, professional and professor, is profess, as in confessing one's faith in or allegiance to, such as a religion or set of beliefs. So it is this faithful set of beliefs that defines professional, whether doctor, lawyer, or architect. more than one's skills, technique, or experience. The challenge we present to you, our students of architecture, is this. As future architects, what will you profess? What will you strongly believe in and uphold? Tonight's speaker clearly professes architecture through both teaching and practice. The title of his presentation is Towards a Reflexive Regionalism. Please join me to extend a warm welcome to Professor Li Xiaodong.
Thank you, Nelson, for the beautiful introduction. I'm flattered. I want to show a video clip before my presentation because I want to make some little bit difference between today's presentation and yesterday's one. Actually, I don't know who did this video. I found out this video from the website a few weeks ago. And the reason I show this video before my presentation is the nowadays, you can easily make a three-dimensional animation of your building before you start a construction, right? And but many years ago, it's impossible. So nowadays, it's getting closer to the design in the final result with the construction quality. So the title is Reflexive Regionalism. We see the world differently because our education backgrounds, because we grew up in different places, and culture, education, and many other things. For example, the spider will have one perspective, different from Leonardo's eagle. The spider will set up a net and then wait for his chance, right? So he could see very close distance things, but not far away. But the eagle can fly very high, and he can see things from above with much larger vision. Take this boat, for example. If you are an engineer specializing in material, you will probably talk about why this boat is made of fiberglass, or steel, or timber, or whatever. Depends on the quality of the material, and so on and so forth. if you are a designer, probably you will more describe this boat by the shape of it, right? How it can be more aerodynamic, and so on and so forth. And also, we can also discuss this one through the description of experience this boat can bring you through this, and finally, here. It's about phenomenology. So the idea of looking at things from different perspective will result differently, right? And then we want to find out the why things take the shape the way it is, like this globe. It's a very common shape in the nature, but somehow nobody asks challenge the question of why a particular object take this particular shape. For instance, why our globe, the Earth, is taking the shape of a globe? All the stars in the sky are in this shape. And why the grapes also take the shape of a globe, right? If you want to also answer the question, it's a bit zen, right? Why these two are similar in terms of shape? But actually, if you try to understand the fundamental reasons why globe is the globe, you understand why. So globe is, the common sense between the two is the largest volume, the smallest surface, right? Because easier for protection. Okay, so for grape, because it's water inside, so you want to keep the water, then you need smaller surface to protect it. The same thing with the earth. And then we understand why the leaves take the shape of like this, because the efficiency of surface to take energy from the sun, the solar energy. And then, actually this one should be the first, because the video clip is trying to present an architectural design. And for this one, is what we used before to present or represent an architectural design, right? And Wright was the first modern architect who used the bird's eye view perspective to represent his architecture in relationship to landscape. And before him, Western architects used perspective with human eyesight to present their design. And Wright learned this bird's eye view perspective from the Japanese and Chinese jiehua, right? And after which, you find out that it's so efficient to present his design in this way, because you can see relationships of landscape, architecture, architecture behind architecture. It's a compound, right? So before Wright, Western architects used this kind of method because Western philosophy saw the world differently from us. So they see the world as there's a subject, there's an object. So the subject look at the object from a particular point of view, the human eyesight. From Renaissance, before the Renaissance, we all see this kind of drawings, right? With a clear perspective. If you look at the mirror inside, you can see the same thing. It's a perspective from human sight, eyesight. But the Chinese one is quite different, because the Chinese philosophy never separate what is subject, what is object. They're all together. With tianren he yi, right? Human being, the sky and earth are together. So we look at the world not from the human eyesight, but from the cosmological point of view. And then, but this method of course also exists in the West, but why they pick up the perspective is because of the geological belief, right? And the nice thing about the bird's eye view is it's holistic. It's not particular angle or particular perspective, but rather it's a holistic presentation. Like this one. Every small piece, if you cut it off, is a complete perspective on its own. So this one is a combination of many vanishing points, perspectives, combined into one piece of painting. And you can see if the building behind. If you stand here looking at the building like this, and make the painting based on the perspective, you will probably only be able to see one small corner of the building. And by this multiple vanishing points, we are able to present a story in the long scroll, which is very famous for Chinese art. And this is a landscape, a typical garden in China. What we have is the, we have pond, water, rocks, probably long covered rocks, trees, and all those elements are combined to create a space in which you have to experience through a very elongated passage to experience the whole garden in a dynamic way, right? Which is quite different from the Japanese garden, which is very still. It's like you sit there and look at the space from a fixed point of view. And why the two cultures are very similar, but why the gardens are different. Okay, they draw inspirations from landscape differently. And in China, the landscape is typical like this, Yellow Mountain, if you happen to be there. You notice that in Yellow Mountain, looking from afar and a close distance, it's quite different. Different timing, different season, you look at different world. Whereas in Japan, the mountain is like this. So with this kind of landscape, you have to experience the mountain in a dynamic process. Where in this kind of landscape, you don't have to. So somehow, inspiration from nature suggested artificial space. And looking from afar in terms of time, China is a beautiful culture with a lot of beautiful things. And looking from afar in terms of distance, in terms of space, China now tried to present itself like this. This is Shanghai, very modern, very high profile, and so on and so forth. But when you look at China from close distance, China is like this. Because of rapid urbanization, lack of reflection, just copy things around and action very fast. So the result is this. And before we build like this, very cautiously chose the site, the timing, and to do the construction, right? So to do construction on the motherland is a very big thing. You don't do it lightweight. But if you can see the contemporary China, the difference is major. And his name is Liang Qichao. You probably know him. A very important historian in contemporary Chinese history. He went to study in Japan. And he realized from Japan that China is simply another culture. And from Japan, he realized that the China used to believe that we are the center of the world, central kingdom, that's what we call it ourselves, right? And he tried to reform when he came back to China, but he failed. The story is very famous, huh? But anyway, he's the first Chinese who realized we are simply another culture. And the second chance we got is from Mao's time. He also tried to somehow establish a new China through which we can live a better life, right? That's his belief. But somehow under Mao's leadership, and there's a very clear ideological belief. And under this framework of ideological beliefs, you have to be in a certain direction, right? So this is the magic color. Landscape painting is banned in total, in general, unless you have this magic color. Doesn't matter how tiny it is. It has to be a celebration of a socialist achievement, somehow like that. Huh? So people believe China as Mao's China. He's the only philosopher, only thinker for the whole country. And then, of course, after the Cultural Revolution, things become very difficult because the whole country is exhausted of creativity. It's like the old patient trying to recover from the illness. In 1979, there was a very famous exhibition in Beijing National Gallery. This painting shocked everyone. This is the real size. I think it's slightly larger than this one. So reality is somehow expanded more than 10 times. And before this one, no reality can be projected 100%. But this one, not just 100%, is 10 times more. So a group of young artists actually use this kind of a surreal way of presenting their work to somehow signal something under the circumstances. Political issues is not clear. What do? We have TV but no program. And the urban landscape is undergoing a tremendous change, but nobody knows where and how. Chai, you know the word China in Chinese, is probably the most used Chinese character for the last 30 years, everywhere. So then the government invited Pei to design something to showcase the Chinese architects, what is contemporary Chinese architecture. And Pei designed this Frequent Hill Hotel in Beijing and showed this presentation to the government people. And they were very disappointed in the very beginning because they were thinking Pei designed something very modern and very Chinese at the same time. And obviously, this one is not modern, right? It's a postmodern. And Pei got a Pritzker Award after this one because he became postmodernist. And the Pritzker jury chairman is Philip Johnson, who was the first laureate of the Pritzker Award. And then he says, you know, welcome, Mr. Pei, you finally become a postmodernist. So Pei got the award. But somehow, Pei explained to the government people that the reason why you're supposed to do building like this is because before you jump into modern society, you have to understand who you are, identify what is Chinese, right, before you make it modern. And by that time, China was very insecure, not confident about the future. Because when we open the door, everything outside is colorful, postmodern world, modernism finished, it's postmodern world. And then China hasn't started the modernization yet. So action slowly. This is what Pei suggested to the Chinese government. And then what happened is after this building, for the two decades in the last century, Chinese architecture works like this. So iconically, you pick up what is Chineseness and then present it into modern building, in the modern function, not modern building. And for instance, this is the one of the project I worked with in after my graduation in Tsinghua. And you can't tell, actually, when you look at this image, when this building was designed or built. It could be 200 years ago, right? So original architecture was understood as something that has to be recognizable in terms of its iconic form. The petrol, the wall, and the windows, and so on and so forth. So this is what happened for China for the last two decades in the 20th century. And then, a few more examples. This is another project in Beijing. Also, the peach roof, white wall. Even though it's a courtyard apartment, it's not courtyard house anymore. The density is different, but somehow the form is still the same as it used to be before. So original architecture is something picturesque or iconic. So the title of my speech is Reflexive Regionalism, right? So I will talk about this later on more in detail. So architecture design becomes a matter of choice instead of a matter of debate. Tradition of modern East or West. That's why Chinese architecture almost like a, you can recognize two faces on one face. This is incredible, right? So this is Chinese architecture. Because the mayor says, okay, the reason why Chinese architecture is nice is beautiful because the big roof. So we must have big roof. So in Beijing in the 90s, every building must have a big roof if you want to get approval from the government. And this is the top 10 most ugly buildings in China from 2 years ago on the website. So what is in common for all those buildings? They are all recognizable in terms of form, right? You know where is this? Yeah, this, this. This is the coins, yeah? And this is a dragon. Here is the Olympic site. Here is also the hotel. So the same thing happened to China Gallery during the World Expo in Shanghai a few years ago. It has to be recognizable Chinese, yeah? So, even this building, a few years ago, from the APEC conference in Beijing, this is exactly the same with this, right? Recognizable Chineseness. So some of the young graduates from overseas came back to China in the end of 90s. When they saw the condition, they decided not to do anything with Chinese culture or with Chinese architecture, but something totally Western, international, universal, okay? So this is the one example. And when you're young, suddenly you've got a chance to design something major like this, half a million square meters, what do you do? Of course, there's different color, different forms, so you try everything, yeah? So overstatement probably is the word to describe the practice back then. It actually, the real size is only this size, this big, but it has to look twice as large, right? This is from Shenzhen, this size, but it has to, you know. Okay, then the, so Kuhas came over. So Kuhas realized right away when he came to China, when he was invited to design this CCTV building, he realized right away, okay, I know what you need. Something strange, something bold. And he is capable and skillful to design something less kitsch, right? But of course, on the cost of a major financial support for this one. This costs twice as much as the Halifa Tower, the largest, the tallest building in the world. Same square meters, this costs twice as much as that one. And not to mention that this building actually was the burned down, and that is the balance of this building. I cannot tore it down, because if you tore down this building, the building will fall. But anyway, by collaboration with star architects from overseas, the Chinese architects learned tremendously the technique, the structure, the concept developments, and so on and so forth. So they start to design modern buildings now. It's modern. But somehow, when you ask questions, but this building can be anywhere, right? Can be in Australia, in Germany, or anywhere else in the world. But this is supposed to be in Fujian province, in China. So why this building is not Chinese? It's modern, but not Chinese. So why has to be Chinese? You probably will ask a question, right? We'll answer that later. And then I will use two examples to elaborate what is the issue of a particular place and why we have a design based on the particular issue. And this is Singapore. And Singapore was established in 1965. After establishment of a new country, the first thing they do is to establish what is Singaporean, who is Singaporean. Most people come to Singapore are Chinese, Indians, Malays, and British, and many others as well. So there are people from different countries, different cultures. Now what is Singaporean? So what they do first is to build up a legendary sculpture. So here is the Bring Line, And then it's a legend that people find out when they arrive in Singapore. So it's like Chinese are the sons of dragon, right? So Singaporeans are the sons of dragon, something like this. So everyone identify themselves with this sculpture. Not enough. We need to build a city. And how? Okay, we don't know. Then what do we do? So we invite international renowned architects from all over the world to design buildings like this. So the first skyline of Singapore was totally constructed by four architects who built the building the same way they built in their hometown. In the end, we have a collage of images from all over the world that when you come over to Singapore from the sea, you look at like a mirage floating in a tropical island, but it has nothing to do with the tropical island. And then the star reflects on this issue. Why is not Singapore? There was a tremendous discussion about what is center, what is the periphery. The periphery tried to become center because the center has ideas more advanced in terms of lifestyle, in terms of know-how, of knowledge, of science and technology and so forth. So China used to be the center in the Song Dynasty, Tang Dynasty, right? But later on become periphery. In the 70s, even Hong Kong is the center, but China, mainland China is the periphery. And so the discussion between the center and periphery is about like this. How the periphery can become center? Okay, the idea is that if you learn from the center only by copy, you never become the center because you give up your own voice. So the idea to become center is to do independent thinking, to identify the problems you have and try to find the solutions to solve the problems, and then you become center, right? This is Ram Guha's design. Not this one. So for him, if reality is dirty, the job of architects is to identify the chance to make a dialogue with reality instead of replace the dirtiness with cleanness, and through which he find out a new way of design. And this is really eye-catching and refreshing when the building was finished in the early 90s. We never saw modern building like this. So the beams comes from nowhere. Eight columns, none of them are identical to each other. And this facade has nothing to do with this facade. The traffic can go through, human beings can go through the building. To the park, it's like the building can be like dissected into different parts. So he designed this building because he thought, okay, if I need people to go through to the park, to the building, why don't I open a gate? If the car has to go through, why don't we open up a tunnel? So if reality is a mix of things, why can't we have eight different columns? So he has a new way of design. And then Singaporean becomes clearer in this kind of a thinking. So if Singapore is not about culture, so what is Singapore about? If you talk about evolution of city, it either is a subjective description of culture in terms of evolution, or is an objective description of nature, right? So in Singapore, there's no culture. That has to be nature. Now nature is about tropicality. So you have to design based on the understanding of tropical life. What is tropical life? Hot. So somehow you have to design a building which is sunproof, the sun shading, cross ventilation, and get the rain off, right? Okay, if you design the building this way, you design tropical building. So here's a tropical building. This is it after the discussion is clear. So they start to design building like this. This window is designed to allow wind comes in during the monsoon season, but not the rain. And this project won the Aga Khan Prize in 2008. by Wuhan. Another example is very tropical, high-rise buildings. Tropical house. And this is a townhouse, which is not typical townhouse we can see from down the street. It's typical, not typical. It's a very unique tropical townhouse. Very porous, light comes in, but not direct sunshine. Layered, but not separated. So raining or not raining doesn't make any difference, right? When you take a shower, right? So there's no need for a roof. So when you are clear about this tropical lifestyle, you have new way of design. And I like this hotel very much. It's about tropical space, yeah? So the whole Singapore is a part of the this hotel. When you look at this, vertical green. Here we come back to Hong Kong. So the issue of Singapore is clear, right? It's about to define modern city tropical lifestyle, right? And in Hong Kong, actually I used some slides from my friends, Gary Chan, probably know him. He talked here before, right? Gary, yeah. In Hong Kong, it's like you don't have land, so we don't have a beach, so we create our own beach, right? So we don't have space, then it has to be multifunctional. And it's like dim sum. I just love dim sum so much. Because I think it's the most healthy fast food in the whole world. And it's standardized, very efficient, but allow diversity. Yeah? This is Gary's house. He was born here, and he still lives here. And this is when he was young. The whole family stayed here. His own bed, parents, sisters, toilet and kitchen and living room. 4 meters by 8 meters, 32 square meters. It's tiny for Chinese standard. Huh? But this is a whole family for 5 family members. And then years later, the family moved out. So Gary owned the whole apartment himself. But felt so spacious. Actually, he designed this space as there's almost like a square and a street. And he feels so luxury. And later on, he found out that if he's the only person in the apartment, he can't use two different functions at the same time. So then different functions are supposed to have different configuration of space, right? And then he designed this building like this. Okay, by moving the curtains and lighting combinations, you can reconfigure the space according to the function. And then, not enough. In the end, he turned the building into this by moving the elements around, and he could make 70 over ways of space. So I just fastly go through this. So he understands Hong Kong very clearly about flexibility, about standardization, but allow diversity. He's very happy. So there's a bridge linking from the bigger issue to the design of a smaller issue. Then you have a nice design. That's how you become center, right? We all know Singapore is now exporting ideas of designs to all over the world. Okay, now China, come to China. This is my approach. China is large. We can't see China, we have one issue or two issues. Different places are different issues, right? So the idea is to define that issue first before you do design. And this is when I was still in Singapore teaching in the US. And after research and studying of architecture for so many years, I haven't designed anything for 15 years between 1989 to all the way to 2002. So then I decided to test out my ideas in this project, the first project in Lijiang for an orphanage. And here is the site. We somehow did fundraising for about 300 over MB, which is nothing if you want to do something big, right? So it's something we have to overcome in terms of budget. And so we have to rely on local resource. So this is regional. This is why everything has to be regional if you want to sustain our society. Here's the site, and this is not a monumental building, but a very important building for the village, because this was owned by American journalist Joseph Rocks, who stayed in this building for 20 years in 1920s. He worked for the National Geographic for 20 years, and he published a lot of papers on Lijiang. And so this building was the only exhibition building of the whole village. So people, the visitors comes to this building, comes to the village to visit Joseph Rocks' exhibition. So the school site is here. So we're supposed to respond to this one and the whole village, and as well as the mountain. So here is the plan, very simple, very straightforward. If you have very limited budget, you have to, I think the it's about this. It's not about the form, but rather about the condition you identify from the program, from the site, from the function that you're going to accommodate. So it's a very straightforward plan, but it has to be earthquake resistant. And we have to use local labor, local material, and local know-how as well. The only modern things we have for, or defamiliarized things in this project is this stairwell. And we actually find out a piece of steel in the junkyard, and then this guy from the village, actually he could help us with the welding, and then we did this one. And the details actually take references from the local way of construction as well. And it's a public building, so it has to be well lit. So the Joseph Rocker's back facade becomes our front facade, together with So we are building up a dialogue between what is new and what is old. And it's not just making a contrast, but making it self-identifiable for its own, but also responsive to the local environment. And during the construction of that project, this guy from Goldman Sachs, he came over to visit Lijiang, and he found out the school. He liked it very much. He says, he came to Singapore, he talked to me, he says, if I bought a piece of land, can you do a design for me? Mm-hmm. So that's my first client. And then we came to this village to look for the site. This is the site he bought. And this is a Yulong Xuanshan, very young, energetic mountain. And you know, when you're from this mountain, you want to build a little house here, it's very dangerous, very difficult as well, right? But we could look for help from traditional Chinese landscape paintings. Okay, so you can obviously see this. Architecture is in very harmonious relationship with the landscape. It's not just something superimposed onto the site, but rather there's a dialogue, right? So there's a balance between what is in, what is young, and so on and so forth. So we need to balance out the young energy with in energy. So what is in energy? Enclosure and water. A large surface of water will help to somehow balance out the young energy. And also we need water surface to help with local climatic conditions because the snow cap mountain need humidity to keep it snow capped. And then what we have here is like this. The same idea with the school, local materials. And imagine this whole building was also constructed by local villagers, except the steel part. Everything else are made, constructed by the local villagers. And the rocks is from here, the timbers, and the waters come from the snow. So the nature, the natural elements turn into artificial. Then you can sense the building actually belongs there. And then when you approach the building to this staircase, what you see is here, when you surface here, you see this building. Very low profile, modest. And it's like, now you see this picture again, you see this snow mountain there. It's not that young, energetic anymore, right? It's more balanced, more softer now because of the refinements of the detailing and water surfaces and also, of course, the material and the low profile. And it's like a French dish. You present a dish with a big plate, the dish looks different. Now we are representing the mountain with this piece of architecture. All the details are functional and technically has to be logical. So the third project is the bridge school in Fujian province. In this project, I tried to test out the idea of the Chinese medication theory and how the idea of seeing a human body as a holistic totality, that every parts are connected through energy flow, right? So whatever happens to your body is a problem of energy flow. Then what we do is like this. We identified this community in this remote village, and there used to be only two castles. So people live here and here. There are rebels before, in between there's a little creek, so they fight with each other. That's why they're separating each other. And the reason why they stay here is because safety reasons, right? And they have a communal center inside the block. But later on, the safety reason is not an issue anymore, so everybody moves out of the castle, but lives in these houses around the castle. The problem is, one, they move out. There's no master plan. So everywhere, as long as you have space, they build buildings there. So the public space is gone. Yeah. So the village becomes like this. Nobody cares about public space anymore. So they're deteriorating. Yeah? So the idea of this project is try to rejuvenate the community through the intervention of an architecture program. Okay, here is the idea. So if it's because of lack of energy, because of lack of communication, so what we do is to build up a bridge over the creek and create two public spaces. And this building has to be the most public buildings in the community. So it's a school. You know, the young kids are the most energetic body of people in the whole community, right? And the two performance stage on both ends, and there's a physical bridge linking the two as well, and there's a library, and underneath the bridge there's also a shop. So this become the most public buildings in the whole village. So connection is the issue. Then the building has to be designed based on the idea of connection. So you see all those tensions are built up. And then we have this. It's It's also a big playground for the kids after school. So the way, the approach to the school is actually you can go up and then slide down or go the other way around. This is the shop. Performance stage for puppy show. The kids are very happy, as you can see. And never before there are visitors to this village, but now almost every day, because of the wide publication of the project, a lot of visitors to the village, and the kids are very happy to see visitors from outside, you know, every day. Okay, the fourth project is the library in Beijing, from Beijing. For this one, we are fortunate to have donations from the Architecture Foundation from Hong Kong, and 1 million RMB to build whatever the one I want to build. Right? So I find this village very interesting. They're very poor again, so they need help financially. So the idea is to build up something similar with the bridge school, so to attract the visitors, right? So then they can have restaurants and accommodations and so on and so forth. So in this case, it's a library. The program is a library, but it has to be very dangerous again, but also it has to be self-sufficient, which means we don't have power supply, which means this building has to keep it air-conditioned on its own. So this is the material I feel very impressive when I visit the village. They're everywhere on the street, in the courtyard, and they use this to cook as well as to warm up the house in winter. So the idea is, why can't this material be used in architecture? So if we can identify a particular material in relation to a particular type of space, that'll be very interesting. So it's not for decoration, but to prevent this too strong sunlight into the space, because this is a reading space, it's a library. So you need to dim down the light and make it comfortable for reading. This is the sketch for that. I'm going to explain this later on. There's 3 layers. So the light actually is filtering through the space. So in the end, the branches all over, it's totally glazed up. And outside is also totally covered by the twigs in 3 layers. Only difference between here and here is that these are 2 layers of glass. In between are the twigs. Here, glass, and then the twigs. And the reason why the 2 levels here, I'll explain later. Here's the entrance. It's a very simple box, but you enter from here, and when you enter from here, actually you go through a very diversified approach instead of going straight, but you'd rather you turn. And then this little corner actually is in the lowest part of the whole block. The reason why this is the lowest point, I will explain later. It's about 6 meters tall. Here's the entrance, lowest point. Here how it works. So in summer, there's a wind tunnel, and cool air, actually over the water surface, will go through this block like this and absorb in by the entrance here. And hot air is here. So the hot air will take in the cool air from this entrance and get out from here. So you feel the breeze, cool air, when you sit here. So we tested in summer. The outside temperature is actually 30 degrees. The inside temperature is about 26.
is the similar temperature with the shadows. And in summer, there's opening here, so air can go through. So the top is not so hot. And in winter, it's closed, so the hot air will be trapped in, and then into the space inside. So the room temperature inside in winter is about 5 degrees higher than outside. So that's how it works by its own, right? So understand the technology is not in terms of air conditioning units, but rather in terms of concept and philosophy. And we didn't do anything of the material. Didn't do any treatment, any chemical treatment. Keep it natural, and everything is recyclable. So someday, we will grow plants like this, and the birds will find the nest here as well. And one day, the building will disappear like this. So it become part of the natural evolution process, right? You see, in winter, it's almost disappeared into the landscape. The rocks were there before, it's not that moved there, right? And we also designed a program how to get the books. We put up a kind of news on the website, so you're welcome to visit the building, and you're welcome to donate and contribute to the library. And you can contribute three and take one books away. So actually, the books keep updating itself. And then this library becomes kind of a platform for social exchange of ideas, right? And we managed to get the whole collection within 3 months. So this is after the finish of the building. It's like the performance is very well coordinated. And I want to talk a little bit about this image. This image was shot by a farmer who doesn't know anything about taking photographs. But during that day, there's heavy snow. I called him out. Can you borrow a camera and take as many as pictures as possible? He says, I don't know how. Just make it flat and make it steady and take as many angles as possible. So pick up this one. Okay. This is another project, the School of Architecture in Tsinghua, the new building. This is my first project inside the city, and in a very small site. This is the existing condition. So the only place I have is in this U-shaped site, which is about 30 meters by 30 meters. So in the end, we have a cube. Nothing much. And almost like a Rubik cube. Yeah. So the idea is that students are stacked here like the IKEA storage room. And they do their works here, expedition works here. And the professors are here. And then everyone shares a central space like this. The light comes from here. The cross ventilation also goes away from here. And I think this is the most abstract building in Tsinghua. Every one building can read how many floors, but you can't read how many floors with this way. We still have time, right? Yeah? Okay. So, because I want to add a little more. This is the final project, okay. But it's much larger. It's a 22 square kilometers urban design. Master plan, as well as urban design. In Chengdu, Dujiangyan, here. Here's Dujiangyan. And it's this part. This is not my denial, but because the local government is not happy, was not happy about this master plan, so I was invited to design something else. And you see, this the problem of this design is to, it used to be looks like this. The idea of this design is to cover the whole countryside by urban space, yeah? So this is the problem. And you see, the problem is this. Again, the big issue like this. Okay, here's China. Hong Kong is here, right? Okay. Only 1/3 of the land is habitable. All the industries, 95% of population, and so on and so forth. And also our agriculture is from here. And during the Cultural Revolution, you all know the story about the descent, the fresh graduates from high school to countryside. The reason behind this is we have no employment in the city. We don't have food. So the young kids are supposed to survive on their own in the countryside. But then, the urban population is only 20% of the whole population, so we have countryside, okay, which is big enough for the millions of young kids. And but somehow, if you see this image, you understand we do have a big population. And now, the urban population is about 50%. And 20 years from now, we're having another 400 million people to be urbanized. And the problem is, if 80% of the population lives in the city, and cities like we turn countryside into a city, then problem we're having is, one day, our economy will slow down. We'll probably decrease one day. If we don't have any new employment, we don't have countryside to go back, then we have problem. Okay, Hong Kong or Singapore, you can buy food from anywhere else. But China, if you want to buy food for 1.3 billion people, it's going to be a disaster for the world, right? So we have to find out a way to how we urbanize the countryside. Okay, so obviously this is the ideal and this is reality. Then there's something wrong about this. This is Shanghai. They're very happy and proud to present to the whole world that we are very advanced. We live in the high-rise buildings and so on and so forth. But you all know that the big cities are very risky in terms of natural disaster or war, whatever. And this image shows a very interesting thing. Probably have seen this kind of image before. Here's Japan, South Korea, North Korea, China. So it's exactly the same as I drew before. So most of the most unpopulated areas here. Countryside is abandoned. But it doesn't mean that the urban living has quality. So we used to do things like this, but now we do things like this. We take the trees away and put up the building like this. So our city looks like this, designed for cars, not for human. So if you want to walk on the grass in the city, you have to be very clear. So those are the points listed by the research on the most habitable cities in the whole world. Human scale, regional character, non-oppressive environment, linkage between past and now and future, sustainable social structure, easy transportation, high green ratio, sustainable and balanced economic development. Okay, in the end, we need to have this kind of a model. A balance between the environment, economy, and society. So this is a site by a bird's eye view shot. And people live here, and here's their land. And they grow potato, they sell potato. They grow rice, they sell rice. So the land value is not extended. So this is the problem. So little individual agriculture cannot sustain. So the idea is, if we can extend the value of the land, we have to do something else by urbanization, right? But we don't change everything into the city, but rather we replan the whole thing. This is the reality, and this is what we do. We organize the thing, collective living, higher ratio of plot ratio, so we could accommodate more people. And then we keep the existing farmland untouched in terms of size. So urban living, the problem with urban living in the big cities is that from one point to another point, it's like moving in the maze, right? You never know what happened in front in terms of traffic. So cloud computing now can help us to understand the situation in a holistic way. And we can do clear shortcut like this. To know the engineer of a shortcut is very important in terms of master plan. The guy who invented Twitter, he's a specialist on the shortcut. So 140 letters is the shortest way to express ideas. And so what we have is this. We have a central service district. We have sub-service district and connected together like this. In between is the land, farmland. And we calculate actually how many new populations can live in this area and by doing like this. And then our future countryside would be looks like this. We have infrastructure, central service area, the whole area is connected by local traffic, badmintons, walking, not by cars. So the idea is to provide the basic requirements and supplies for people living there. Everyone has employment instead of everyone has a big car, a big house. Collective living doesn't mean a lower quality of living. As long as you design it according to the necessity of the people living there. We keep some of the original one to promote the tourism. And research for new products for agriculture. Labor intensive, but high value return. accommodate more. And we can also incorporate art to promote tourism. We don't want to live in the city anymore, right? Everyone want to live here, right? Okay, so the idea is to increase nature, and reduce, make it more efficient. And if urbanization create more carbon dioxide, so if we see this separate, urbanization as in rural urbanization and deurbanization will create more oxygen and less carbon because we reduce the size. This will be the future countryside. No, thanks. Very different from this series.
Thank you so much, Professor Li, for an inspiring presentation. I think you exemplify this phrase that I've been using recently of being the grounded visionary, being innovative, but very much down to earth, solving real problems. I think we have a few minutes for questions, if there are any from the audience. Professor Yano.
Thank you very much for the wonderful lecture. I have one quick question, because you spent quite a long time at the beginning talking about the your understanding of what happened to different cities around the world. And you talked about the Singapore being the kind of result of reaction against the kind of the what they saw were kind of the characteristic of the city, the kind of tropical cities. you talked a little bit about kind of Hong Kong being the kind of about kind of reappropriation of the space and the kind of efficiency driven kind of urbanization. So I was hoping that you would actually summarize the what you thought were happening in China from your own perspective.
To summarize what happened. I think the last project is to summarize.
So
because
how should I read that?
It has to be problem driven. And what happens in China now is not problem driven. It's more like we pretend to understand the future. We look at the future from the current point of view. But actually, we're supposed to look at the current condition from the future point of view, looking backwards. Okay, so what's the future? The future is we don't have any resource. We have more population. So we have to somehow make our design more sufficient in terms of use of material, resource. And then if we do that, we understand what kind of policy we're supposed to adopt. So this is why I call it reflexive regionalism. So before you decide what is regionalism, it has to be a dialogue before you understand what is regional.
Thanks for the nice presentation. As I understand, in your beautiful building, I've seen that when you have a special context, as I understand it, you can produce a kind of special architecture. But when you are in a generic context, like today China City, you agree can there is a possibility to produce generic architecture. So you can, I think about this challenge, how to produce.
Yeah, it depends on where. I'm designing actually a big school in Shenzhen. It's in the center of the city. And the issue is very clear actually, as we identified. It's a small site, 20,000 square meters, but we have to design a major school of 80,000 square meters, four times. The plot ratio is four times. And of course, the density is a big issue, high density. Normally in the school project, you have at least a big piece of land. You have building, you have sports facilities, for instance, right? And in Shenzhen, they don't have any tropical buildings. Of course, here it's not tropical, it's subtropical, at least 11 months hot, right? So similar with Singapore in a sense. And so in that case, I have to define the issue as in a combination of high density school in a tropical, subtropical area with clear understanding or new understanding of what is education and how we accommodate the sports facilities, for instance, is in a high density space. So the design, I don't have it with me yet, it's in my pocket. I can't show it yet. It's about, you know, for school, normally what you have is a building and a sports field. But in my case, I have to design over six separate individual sports facilities to accommodate 2,000 students. So every week, every student could have 4 hours sports hour. And actually I designed 14 of them. So separate sports facilities in different corners. So somehow it's a mixture of things in that building. So as your question is, how to identify issues, I think this is the typical case. It doesn't matter if it's in the countryside or it's in the city, it depends on the issue, the program, the site, and the bigger issues, again. So the combination of them, yeah. I hope I can show you that one, but maybe after 2 years when the building finishes.
That's a comment. Colin Fernier, do you have a microphone? Oh, Patrick, do you have a question?
You use the term a reflexive regionalism.
Yeah.
Obviously, in my interpretation to, in a way, echo Frampton's critical regionalism.
Not exactly critical. Like,
so can you explain what
Yeah, the critical, you know, my PhD supervisor at Sinosonius was actually the first one who coined terms critical regionalism. Mm-hmm. For critical regionalism, it's more about criticality is the key.
of, you know, they use the word defamiliarization in terms of form making. Okay, you respect the reality of globalization, but at the same time, you accept regional differences. So the defamiliarization is trying to use change or defamiliarized form to pinch the consciousness. So, but in my case, I think that one is too intentional in terms of design. Because criticality comes with the idea that you feel not happy about reality. But it doesn't provide solutions unless you have the idea of how to reconstruct based on the understanding. But the understanding has to be on reflexive thinking, dialogue. So that's why I call reflexive regionalism instead of critical.
I'm also very impressed with the presentation, and particularly with the way you built up towards your final suggestion that maybe rural development could actually start counteracting the trend to urbanization. Most thinkers and practitioners tend to consider urbanization as something which we can't do anything about. It is a fait accompli which we will not be able to in any way hold back. So my question to you is, how sympathetic is the central government in mainland China or in a provincial government to the fact that what you're proposing could be a trend which would start healing the problems due to constant urbanization and densification?
What do you mean? You mean the, what their attitude about my design?
Yes, how receptive are the government authorities to this very radical counter-proposal?
The Chinese government is probably the most complicated government in the whole world. Every local government is different from each other. But somehow, there's a very general tendency as well. They listen to, of course, whoever is in the tallest, right? But somehow, there's no clear idea so far. And the reason behind, I think, is very political in the current time. But if you listen to what the Prime Minister Li Keqiang mentioned during the conference, recent conference, or no, 2 years ago, he actually talked about urbanization and how to keep the farmland. And my proposal, actually 6 years ago, this one, is not executed, still not executed yet, because the local government, there are two group of people, the mayor and the director of urban planning. The urban planning director, who is actually, you know, a graduate from Tongji, who is a rival of Tsinghua, you know, they don't like Tsinghua's guy to design something for them. The mayor likes my idea, but now the mayor is off, and this director of urban planning becomes the mayor. So he doesn't like the idea. So this, it's a pity, I'm still waiting for the green lights. And so that's a problem in China. So that's the reason also I don't like work with the government, you know, with the public buildings. There's always hidden agenda, what is going to be the right solution, or can you execute your design? And I never participate in any competitions also because of that. Yeah. Difficult, yeah.
Any other questions? If you permit me a very brief follow-up on this governmental issue. When Xi Jinping announced what was translated to English as no more weird architecture,
right.
What are the consequences, whether intentional or not? I don't think he means to go back to the period of every building having a tile roof, like the mayor of Beijing. That's not the intention.
No.
And I think it's to eliminate some of the top 10 examples of where
exactly.
But is there any other agenda in terms of a regional character of architecture in China?
I think he is right in the sense he only mentioned we don't do strange buildings, but he didn't mention that you should do what kind of buildings. I think that's at least is a good signal. Yeah. But you know, the interpretation from the locals, you never know. Because they probably will say, okay, this is a strange building, we don't do that. This is a strange building, you know. It's all up to interpretation, I guess. Yeah.
All right, if there are no other questions, my last order of business for the evening is to present to you, Professor Li, a gift, a small token of our appreciation.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.